verses 1 to 12. You may exceed some of these readings, but there are, you need to read more than less. It's not more or less, it's more that we should be reading about in the Bible. Now, if you found the body of verses, would you kindly say amen?
Amen.
Amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 10. I'd just like to read verse 27 of chapter 9 before verse chapter 10. This is very important. Paul says, but I keep under my body and bring it into what?
Subjection.
What is another word for subjection? When you keep your body under subjection, is it chaotic? Is it unruly? Does it have a run of its own? No, it's under control. It is subjected to a higher authority. But I keep under my body and bring it into subjection. That is a conscious thought. It's not just something that happens without you making it happen, necessary form. Lest, you see the effect of this, lest that by any means, when I have preached to others, so these are for preachers, and teachers, and parents, and those who are tasked with responsibilities, church responsibilities, as well as so-called lighter responsibilities to impart knowledge and truth to others. Lest that by any means when I have preached to others, I myself should be a castaway. But there's every danger that, like, we're not careful about who we are and what we do, the responsibilities that we assume, and that we do not keep our body under subjection. You notice that your body is beneath your brain, not your brain beneath your body. God has given us the center and given it amazing capabilities and powers, faculties, or the telescope, the thoughts that you entertain and are translated into actions of the body. Now let's read verse 10, chapter 1 of verse 10, rather verse 1 of chapter 10. Moreover, brethren, so it's addressing the church, I would not that you should be ignorant how that all our fathers, referring to the past, referring to the Old Testament, referring to the patriarchs and the prophets, all our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea. What sea was that? The Red Sea. And what was that cloud that was over them? At the cloud that Christ was there, his very presence was in the cloud by day and the fiery pillar by night, his actual presence. He says, so all of us, and he's reminding people of history. You see, if we don't learn from history, we won't know who God is, because God is the same. Yeah. First of all, he says he's the same yesterday. That's history, right? Today, that's present. And tomorrow, that's future. Over all time, time and generations, it's so wonderful to know that God is the same. We change, he doesn't. He's unchangeable. He who can see the end from the beginning, and is called the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last. If you read that carefully in the book of Revelation, you will find that those who misinterpret it say that the end of the law, Jesus is the end of the law, they are not reading the rest of what it talks about, Jesus being the beginning and the end. Does Jesus begin and end? No, he lives forever. And we're all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and they did eat all the same spiritual meat. That's of the Word of God. And they all drink the same spiritual drink, and it's being qualified here as spiritual. And all did drink of that spiritual rock that fouled them. How clearly it's explained. Ooh, that rock, that huge boulder, that right in the middle of the desert that was bone dry, when Moses followed God's instructions to strike it, out flowed water more pure than your purified water today. What's the most pure water that's in existence today? You paid $5,000 for the equipment, right? Nothing purer than the water that flowed from the rock, because it represented the blood of Christ that flowed from his time when he was pierced for our redemption. But notice the word bought. But with many of them, God was not well pleased. So we're learning from the past, friends. We're going to go back to where we left off last Sabbath. God was not well pleased, for they were overthrown in the wilderness. Cause and effect. There was a reason for that. God is not unreasonable like man is. Now, notice what it says, and I want you to underline these verses in your Bible. Now, these things were our examples to the intent. That's the intention, or the end. That's the word. That's this, the word end. This is the end, or the intention, that we should not lust after evil things as they also lusted. How's the reason for that? Neither be idolaters, as were some of them. It is written, people sat down to drink and eat, and then they rose up to play. It's a description of what happened among God's people while Moses was still receiving the law up in the now. Neither let us commit fornication, and we read verses in the New Testament where fornication is classified under the works of the flesh. That they which do those things shall not inherit eternal life. As some of them committed and fell in one day 320,000. That's a lot of people. A lot of God's people, that is. Neither let us tempt Christ, as some of them also tempted and were destroyed of servants. Neither murmur ye, as some of them also murmured and were also destroyed by servants. Whether they were committing fornication or murmuring, one of them were destroyed by the servants. So if you think, well, I'm just not going to commit fornication, I'm just going to murmur, well, the same thing will happen anyway. It's a consequence. God doesn't change. And again, this is a repetition of what we just read in verse 6, and an expansion of it. Verse 10. Remember, Paul was writing epistles or letters to the churches in the various places where they had set up the Christian church in the Christian era, and Paul was called to be the apostle to the Gentiles and also to the Jews. So your Christians in the days when these epistles were written in the New Testament had two general types of Christians that were receiving instructions from the apostles, the Word of God, written to them. They were the Jewish converts into Christianity. The Jewish people were the first persecutors of Christ. And second, the Gentile converts who came from pagan practices. Both of them carried into the fledgling church their old practices. And Paul had to struggle. No wonder. I was thinking, why did God have to raise an apostle Paul when he had already a 12 apostle group to take care of business? It's because it required a very special person who could handle the great challenges that were posed by a combination of two strongly willed, strongly cultured people. But we're being converted gradually, as the sun rises gradually. They had to deal with all these things. So when you're reading the Bible in the New Testament, be very careful. That's why there are so-called introductions to the book. It will tell you who the book is being written for and what particular promise they're dealing with. Like Galatians, you should read that very carefully. James is written to the Jewish converts. So they're not the same entirely. They have differences. There are nuances that the Holy Spirit can show you. Plus, a disciplined approach towards reading the Bible makes a big difference in the way you come to a conclusion. Verse 10 or verse 11. Now all these things happen unto them for what? What does your Bible say? Example here in the King James Version, it says ensamples of saying. It's examples. These things were happened unto them. They're not fictitious, they're not fake news, it actually happened. These things happen unto them for examples, and they are written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the world are come. So if you and I truly believe that we're living at the edge of time, or the time of the end, and certainly the signs of the times, both here in the United States and in the world around us, wherever you go today, the internet has made things come closer to us instantaneously, where before we had to wait for the morning papers and to give the headlines about 3 in the morning. But today everything is happening. The world can now be born instantly if they wanted to have an ear. That's why the book of Revelation says, he that hath an ear, let him hear. And you and I are in this generation where that particular introduction or warning to seven churches in Revelation, meaning all the churches, regardless of denominational peculiarities, is that we need to hear what the Spirit is convicting us. Know what this one says there? Now all these things happen unto them for ensamples, and they are written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the world are come. Wherefore, let him that thinks he stands take heed lest he fall. Pride goeth before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall. It is thy gentleness and meekness that makes him great. You see, either or, when you say those guys are doing works in order to be saved, they're Pharisees. Or to say, I don't do any works, I'm already saved, both claim to have been saved already. Friends, to understand this whole exercise is to remember that any time we entertain the idea that we are already saved, we begin to fall, or we will fall. It is to know that God is with us, and be in harmony with doing God's will, because we want to be with Him. And He has prescribed the conditions in which we can be married to Him. And that can be understood by everyone who has become married. And we're called the bride of Christ, but have to be purified. Notice Ephesians 5, that He will present His bride as what? Pure. Therefore, the bride has to be purified. Wherefore, my dearly beloved, flee from idolatry. That's now, here Paul is talking to those who know the Word of God. are in danger of feeling content and feeling self-competent and not depending on Christ. They're depending upon themselves and their interpretations of what it means. Paul takes them not to task, but he takes them where they should always be and where we should always be, willing to be taught of God and going back to the examples that were showing how God's own people. Remember, the Old Testament wasn't written to the pagans or the heathen. They were written to the Israelites and to the Jews, God's people. Now, so let's go back right now to Exodus chapter 32. All right, this is where we left off last week, and I'm thankful that we were able to continue what we were doing last week. Exodus chapter 32. Exodus chapter 32, verses 28 to 30. If you want to catch up, then you certainly need to catch up 3 verses prior to Exodus 32, 28 to 30. How many of you found it? Say amen.
Amen.
All right. You see, let's go back a little. So you see what Paul is referring to, where they ate, they drank, and they rose up to play. This is what he was referring to when he pointed out in verses 18 and 19 in the conversation between Joshua and Moses as they were descending from the mount carrying the first tables of stone on which God had written the Ten Commandments on the two sides. In verse 18, Moses replies to Joshua, who said, you know, there is a noise of war in the camp. And Moses said, it is not the voice of them that shout for mastery or for victory, neither is it the voice of them that cry for being overcome or defeated, but the noise of them that are singing. Noisy singing. And it came to pass, as soon as they came near unto the camp, that they saw the calf, the golden calf, the symbol of the sun worship, in Mithraism, covered the whole Middle East back there. And Moses' anger waxed hot, and he cast the tables out of his hands and broke them beneath the mountain, where the calf was mounted on. And he took the calf which they had made and burned it in the fire and ground it to powder and spread it upon the waters and made the children of Israel in idolatry. He reprimanded by God through Moses that hurling of the two tables of stone carrying the writings of God himself was symbolic of Israel breaking the law, not Moses. That's why Moses was not punished for it. And Moses said unto Aaron, what did this people unto thee that thou hast brought so great a sin upon them? And Aaron said, let not the anger of my Lord wax hot. Thou knowest that thy people, that they were set on mischief. And they said to me, make us gods. Can you make a god? Certainly you can, but it's a false god. We shall go before us, for us, for this Moses, the man that brought us up out of the land of Egypt, he acknowledged that he led them out of Egypt. We do not know what has become of him. And I said unto them, whosoever hath any gold, and that's Aaron, arguing and trying to explain his way, squirming his way out of that very tight situation. Whosoever hath any gold, let them break it off, so they give it to me. And so I cast it into the fire, and there came out this cup. We went through this last week. So please, you know, don't try to add iniquity to iniquity. How can you throw something into a fire, and then the fire itself spits out a finished product, a golden calf. It's lying. That's not even deflection. That's not alternate facts. That's lying. And when Moses saw that the people were naked, you see now, you read through this, that's why I want to continue going forward on 28 to 30. And the children of Levi, that's why they were chosen to be the priestly tribe. This is what happened. There was a test. They passed the test. They received a special dispensation as the priesthood. And the children of Levi did according to the word of Moses, because Moses said, who of you did not join this apostasy? And only the tribe of Levi stepped out, and they told them, slay all of them, and they did the terrible work under the directions of God. For Moses had said in verse 29, consecrate yourselves today to the Lord, every man upon his son and upon his brother, that you may bestow upon you a blessing this day. God hasn't changed. That too will happen today. Remember, all these things happen unto them as what? Examples unto us upon whom the ends of the world come. Why would Paul write such a counsel if that's an Old Testament application limited only to the Israelites? It is present truth, friends. We better understand this. And it came to pass on the morrow that Moses said unto the people, you have sinned a great sin, and now I will go up unto the Lord. Peradventure I shall make an atonement. Sounds familiar, right? What does the word atonement mean? At one minute. That is reconciliation through blood for your sin. And Moses returned unto the Lord and said, all of these people have sinned a great sin and have made them gods of gold. Yet now, if thou wilt forgive, notice the mercy. We were talking about God's mercy last week, God's mercy today. If thou wilt forgive their sin, and if not, blot me, I pray thee, out of thy book which thou hast written. Now you see here a very significant doctrine, that our names are written in a book. And they do not remain there permanently unless our sins are blotted out. Either our names are not blotted out, or they will be blotted out if our sins are not blotted out. Both cannot remain on that book. We'll talk about that a little bit later. Therefore now go, lead the people into the place of which I have spoken unto thee. Behold, my angel shall go before you. Nevertheless, in the day when I visit, I will visit their sin upon them. And I, the Lord, plague people, because they made the calf which Aaron made. And was Aaron the older brother of Moses, supposedly the high priest man? And chapter 33, and the Lord said unto Moses, depart and walk hence, which thou, says, go up hence, thou and the people which thou has brought up out of the land of Egypt into the land which I swear unto Abraham and to Isaac and to Jacob, saying, unto thy seed will I give thee. Now you know why this is important? This tells us that John 14:1-3, that God has gone to prepare a place for us, and we therefore should be preparing to go to that place which is prepared for us. And the land of Canaan, the earthly Canaan, and the preparation required for that is a type of the heavenly Canaan that God is preparing for us, and He wants us to prepare to inherit the place. Now notice this. If you turn your Bible to verse 13, This is Moses, who is able, just like Abram, because of his relationship with God, to talk straight to God and make his case before God, face to face. You and I have this hope that if we reach the place of relationship with him, that we can do the same. Verse 13, now therefore I pray thee, if I have found, what's the word?
Grace
in thy sight. Show me now thy way, that I may know thee. See the connection? That I may find grace in thy sight, and consider that this nation is thy people. And he said, my presence shall go with thee, and I will give thee rest. Isn't that wonderful? The presence of God is the only, assurance that we will have rest. You can go any place in this world, the most secure one, with all, you know, security guards and all that. This kind of rest comes from the presence of God in us. And he said unto me, if thy presence go not with me, carry us not out. In other words, Moses understood what this meant. And that's important. God is saying something, we have a different idea. We'll never be rest our minds. We must be on one page. Then we'll understand each other. For wherein shall it be known here that I and thy people have found grace in thy sight? How will I know? Is it not in that thou goest with us? So shall we be separated or different, I and thy people, from all the people that are on the face of the earth. Now you see this familiar passage, you'll find it in 2 Peter, where there's a peculiar people, a distinct people, are we. And the Lord said unto Moses, I will do this thing also that thou hast spoken, for thou hast found grace in my sight, and I know thee by name. And he said, and I don't know if we ever will have the courage to do this, if we know what we're asking for. Moses knew what he was asking for. Or maybe he did not at that point in time know enough of what he was asking. And he said, I beseech you, show me thy glory. Well, he was asking something entirely different now. And he said, God said, I will make all my, did he say glory?
Yes.
Know this much, follows. I have a sport that you read this. Moses, in the conversation, says, show me thy glory, God. And says, I will show you the following. All my goodness will pass before thee, and I will proclaim the name of the Lord before thee, and I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and I will show mercy on whom I will show mercy. And he said, thou canst not see my face. Remember, that's the more direct answer to showing his glory. You will not see my face, for there shall no man see me and live. And then the Lord said, behold, there is a place by me. Oh, how I love this. We should be content when we're asking to see the glory of God. To be content with what Jesus, or God, told Moses. Put your name right here, and says, there is by me, close by me, behold, thou shalt stand upon the rock. Number one, who is the rock?
Jesus Christ.
First, you need to stand by the rock. And then it shall come to pass, while my glory passes by, that I will put you in the cleft of the rock. Okay, you see how God prepares him to be able to see that part which he could tolerate and shield him from that portion which he could not, even as close as he was to Christ. I will have to put you in the cleft of that rock. And then I will cover you with my hand when I pass by. We cannot look upon the glory of God and we are going to be trapped in this sinful, corruptible nature. Not yet. But enough of God's glory in a different way is to be revealed to all who seek Him. And I will take away my hand, and thou shalt see my back. Now here we go. This is our idea. Yet if you see my back, you wouldn't like looking at my back, because I like to scratch my back all the time. There are all red spots right there. That's not because of blood. That's because of scratching. God's back is something different. And thou shalt see my back parts, but my face shall not be seen. And the Lord said unto Moses, chapter 34, and I want you to continue reading this with me. This is so important, because so many people say, I have seen the glory of God. I was watching on television. I said, what kind of glory do you see? No man can see the glory of God in you. And the Lord said unto Moses, hew thee. And as I was reading to this twice, when God's glory was revealed to Moses, it was always in connection with giving the law. So anyone who tries to separate the two will not be able to stand in the place that Moses stood. You read it yourself. The second time, the Lord said unto Moses, hew thee. The first time he didn't tell Moses that. He gave Moses the stone or the tables of stone because it was broken. He says, now you hew two tables of stone like the first. So this is the second. And I will write upon these tables the words that were in the first tables which thou breakest, and be ready in the morning. And come up in the morning unto Mount Sinai, and present thyself there to me in the top of the mount. This is a mountaintop experience. And no man shall come up with you, neither let any man be seen throughout all the mount, neither let the flocks nor herds feed before the mount. And he hewed two tables of stone like unto the first, and Moses rose up early in the morning. I like that early thing. You know, when you wake up late, you'll never get up into the mountain. And the Lord had commanded him, and he took in his hand and the two tables of stone, and the Lord descended in a cloud. So he's there in a cloud. And he stood with him there and there you go now. Remember the first discussion? Show me you. Show me. I want to see your glory. And there he proclaimed the name of the Lord. And the Lord passed by before Moses and proclaim, the Lord God, what's the next word?
Merciful.
And what we were talking about this morning? The Lord God, merciful and gracious and long-suffering and abundant in goodness and truth. And then here comes what we were doing last Sabbath, the topic really, showing mercy unto thousands of generations, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, that will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and upon the children's children and unto the third and fourth generation. Moses made haste, bowed his head towards the earth and worship, and he said, if now I have found grace in thy sight, O Lord, let my glory, I pray thee, go among us. Let your presence be among us. For it is a stiff-necked people, and pardon our iniquity and our sin, and take us for thine inheritance. And then a covenant is made between them. Friends, I just want to stop right there. There are things here that we have been reading and not connected. It's about time that we learn to read the Bible very carefully. The glory of God is His presence or His character. and His law. This is what is under attack today. And as Paul writes, you are our epistles, not written with ink, but written in the hearts of men, to be witnesses unto the world, and to angels and to men. Now let me tell you, just to close this, as important as our salvation is, angels, as they are from heaven, and they live in heaven as their home, have to understand the plan of salvation. They don't understand. Christ's revelation in the human nature as a mystery of incarnation, and I was reading this the other night, was to reveal God to the angels. I had to read it again. I was thinking, wait a minute. I thought that Christ was the revelation of God as the express image of God to man. That in order that the angels could see God in Christ. So as important as our salvation is on this earth, it is to glorify the name of God, which has been maligned by Satan, and to reveal throughout the universe the love of God and the power of God.